vuoksi menneen.
Tervetuloa jälleen Timoteo Mikkosen tuotannon pariin.
Tänään vuorossa on todellinen klassikko vuodelta 1977, US Media.
Kyseessä on kolmiosainen dokumenttisarja Yhdysvaltain tiedotusvälineistä, ja tänään näemme sarjan ensimmäisen osan.
Luvassa on melkoinen harvinaisuus, sillä sitä ei ole esitetty julkisuudessa sitten 70-luvun.
Kyseessä on myös yksi Timotean merkittävimmistä teoksista, ja se palkittiin ilmestymisvuonnaan New Yorkin TV- ja elokuvafestivaaleilla. Joten tässä teille US Media osa 1.
Hyvää iltaa, hyvät katsojat. US Media tarkoittaa USA:n joukkoviestintää, sitä mahtavaa koneistoa, jolla tietoa välitetään sähköisesti, painettuna ja heijastettuna, niin tuon rakastetun ja vihatun, ihailun ja halveksitun maan rajojen sisä- ja ulkopuolella. Ja US Media, jos mikä, on todella ylikansallinen vaikuttaja. Kamppailu katsojaluvuista on välähdyksiä ja keskustelua televisiosta Yhdysvalloissa, lähetysverkkojen kiihkeästä katsojien ja vallan tavoittelusta ja tämän kaiken vaikutuksesta sekä sanoman laatuun että vastaanottajiin. Siinä voi helposti käydä kuin vierivälle kivelle.
Once upon a time you dressed so fine, through the bumps of dime in your prime. Beware, doll, you're bound to fall. You thought they were all kidding you. You used to laugh about everybody that was hanging out. Now you don't talk so loud. Now you don't seem so proud about having to be scrounged.
Harvard Square, Kenmore Square, and the Prudential Center in Boston, plus 11 convenient suburban locations. Yeah. You're listening to WCAS in Cambridge, 740 on your AM type radio. This is Linda Ronstadt.
Kinds of winners yesterday, and we'll be telling you about that. Here's Tom T. Hall. I got that fox on the run on KAYQ.
She walks through the corn leading down to the river. Her hair shone like gold in the hot morning sun. She took all the love that a poor boy could give her and left me to die like a fox on the run.
Like fox,
like fox,
like fox.
Are you in the barrel again tonight?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Listen, we have here a thing called Bars and Tone for news inserts.
Yeah, they're straight up.
No aerosols
spray, no roll-on.
Lightning! Lightning! Some lightning for me! Some lightning for you!
Onko televisio vain todellisuudesta unohduksiin harhauttava pelle, kun mielikuvat menestyksestä ja onnesta pyydystetään elokuva- ja televisiokameroiden linssien kautta miljoonien ja taas miljoonien ihmisten verkkokalvoille?
Do people here deserve a better media than they have at the moment?
I think absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, no question about it. I would like to see not so perhaps so much a better quality as a more diverse quality. We've got an excellent television for sort of popular, soporific, low-grade entertainment. No, there's no complaint about that. And I'm not deploring that. I'm sure that we should have television serials for people who want to go to sleep at night and have no other interests. But what we do need is a good intellectual channel.
Näin joukkoviestinnän käytännön mahtimies, TV-tuottaja Norman Lear ja akateemisen teorian ja käytännön kokenut sekoittaja John Kenneth Galbraith näkivät tarve- ja tarjontakuilun olemassaolon. USA:ssa toimii yli 1000 televisioasemaa, eli yksi noin 200 000 asukasta kohti. Kaupallisilla televisioyhtymillä, ABC:llä, American Broadcasting Companylla, CBS:llä, Columbia Broadcasting Systemillä ja NBC:llä, National Broadcasting Companylla, on kullakin noin 200 paikallisen aseman lähetysverkostot komennettavanaan. Myös riippumattomia, siis kaupallisia, mainostuloin rahoitettuja paikallisia televisioasemia ja asemaryhmiä on noin 100. Ei-kaupallisen television mahdollisuudet tasavertaiseen tarjontaan ovat vähäiset, sillä kolmen suuren, armoton kilpailu paremmuudesta määrällisesti sanelee pelin hengen. Ohjelmapäällikkö Charles Gingold kertoo enemmän katu-TVn aamulähetyksessä.
ABC has, which was perennially the number three network, we've risen our ugly heads, and now CBS and NBC are having to contend with what was the third network and look to catch us now. Interestingly enough, a lot of the prognosticators for the new season thought that ABC had a chance, but it's coming true. The one thing that they did not anticipate is that NBC would be number two year to date. Of course, it's a brand new season. CBS, for the first time in their history, at this juncture, doesn't mean this what right. is what will resolve, is presently third.
Mr. Halberstam, how would you describe the holy power structure between ABC, CBS, and NBC? Does it exist?
Well, they're obviously rivals and they are competitive. Whether there is as much diversity in the rivalry as one would really want is another question. I mean, it is not a monopoly situation, yet the norms of the three are so similar. The drive for ratings, the drive for profits, that they end up in a curious way, although being competitive with each other, being kind of almost caricatures of each other, almost interchangeable. You can take the programming chief from CBS and he goes to ABC and he learns how to put the same kind of programs on there, so that there is a lack of diversity that I think one would really like to have in our television networks.
The big change in American television, I think, was created when the ABC network hired the man who was considered to be the most creative, the man having the most expertise in the area of programming, and that is Fred Silverman, who ABC hired from the CBS television network.
Well, I think they're very nervous. I mean, the field is so wide open to do quality things. I mean, even our public broadcasting network, which is, in terms of financing, I mean, a stepchild compared to, I mean, tiny and really with very little money, with that money does so many good things that the contrast between the occasional vitality of the public broadcasting network and the kind of stereotyped programming of the networks is a serious problem. I mean, they program, I think, the lowest common denominator in our society.
I don't think anyone really aims at the lowest common denominator, because I don't even know what the highest common denominator is. So I really don't know whether we can do that.
And there is a kind of contempt for quality broadcasting. I mean, with rare exceptions, I mean, they will do one or two things a year that they will point with pride to. But essentially, there's a kind of plastic, antiseptic, high violence, detective story banality that dominates those networks.
PBS, Public Broadcasting System, eli vapaasti kääntäen kansan yleisradiojärjestelmä, pyrkii epäkaupalliseksi vaihtoehdoksi. Mutta tekninen valmius ei yksin riitä.
Well, we have a public broadcasting system, of course, with 260 affiliated stations, so virtually every community now has access to Sesame Street, Electric Company, good British and American drama. The problem with the public television network is that it is still underfunded.
Public broadcasting, the PBS, the whole PBS setup, has a problem because I think they lack a mission. I think they do anything but service the public. I think commercial broadcasting is servicing the public more than public broadcasting. So the problem is, once they have a mission, I think they'll be much stronger. Right now, all they do is imitate, as you said, the commercial broadcasting with less money and less skilled people.
From the viewer's point of view, it has to be said it's growing stronger. There are better programs being produced at higher standards of production quality than ever before. And these programs are attracting more viewers from a wider cross-section of the population than before. So it's getting stronger. It has its problems as a system, but from the viewer's point of view, it's more attractive.
The practice all around the world has been to supply television funds, either directly through the government or through a tax. I don't think the tax is wholly practical in our case, so I would do it through much larger government grants, yes.
I prefer the mixed system. I would like to see the present private operations of the networks continue, but it's been a source of great disappointment to me that we have not provided adequate funding for public broadcast, and I would like to have seen that happen in 1976. I wish we could have used this bicentennial occasion to launch a strong, secure, well-founded and well-funded public broadcast network in the United States. I think it could have done more to help Americans understand their history, their culture, the problems of the contemporary world than any other single thing we might do.
If I might add just a word there, although the grants, one should have large and ample financing, they're still small in relation to what we spend for picking up sand on Mars or a manned bomber. The amounts would still be relatively small.
It started with high hopes in the 1960s, but was gradually whittled away by interests that I think did not want to see public broadcast triumph in the United States.
Edellytykset PBS:n kehittämiseksi ovat paljolta kiinni presidentin ja hallituksen halusta kanavoida dollareita, mikä on kaksiteräinen kysymys sekin.
The big question, I think, about new funding sources for public television, it lies not with the foundations, nor with companies, but with federal government agencies. Now, by that I don't mean the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, which was set up specifically to support public broadcasting, but the ordinary line agencies that are part of the administration, like the Office of Education, or the National Endowments for the Arts and Humanities, or the National Science Foundation. Now, these are agencies with political mandates set up by Congress, and they fall under the direction of the president. And in the last several years, more and more of these agencies have offered very great sums of money for the production of programs that are meant to be shown on public television. Indeed, this station, WGBH, has received some of those grants, and some of our most important programs enjoy support from that source. But we wonder ourselves whether we can long go on accepting such grants or seeing them expand without courting the danger that public broadcasting will become an arm of government activity as opposed to an independent institution.
Good evening and welcome to Pantechnicon, your nightly magazine on the arts, entertainment, and ideas. Our guest tonight is Eric Severide, but first we'll hear from Louis Lyons, our commentator.
Mitä sitten ohjelmiston tason kannalta merkitsee se, onko asema PBS:n vai jonkun kaupallisen verkoston osa?
The advantage, I think, of public broadcasting is that we decide on the programming based on a certain quality. And then the audience reacts to it, as opposed to commercial broadcasting, where you do have to be concerned about how the advertiser feels about the type of programming that you have.
We try to do programs that we think the commercial stations are not going to do. We try to broadcast shows that we feel would otherwise not be seen in this region. Now, what does that mean? That means that we broadcast a good many documentaries. See, we feel that there are enough people out here who want good, sensitive, different programming that we can survive. We know that they are a small part of the population, but we feel there are enough of those people that we will get the financial support we need and we will continue to survive and be able to broadcast what we're broadcasting.
Do you think that PBS will be someday a fourth power in the television programming here?
It's a viable entity right now, but I don't think so, because American television programs for the masses. Public broadcasting is targeted to the more intellectual element of our viewing audience. As long as they direct their programming towards this singular group, I don't look to public broadcasting as a contender in terms of generating the same kinds of ratings and share of audience that the primary commercial networks do. I don't see it happening. But I think that they're very effective in their role, and public broadcasting in this country has improved significantly in the last couple of years. It'll be around.
But of course, other things are happening, such as pay cable, and there's even talk of creating independent networks. But I don't think it will be easy to beat or cause any sustained consternation at the three commercial networks, which absolutely dominate broadcasting in this country.
Kenellä on todellinen sananvalta Yhdysvalloissa? Voiko joku yksityinen henkilö tai valtaryhmittymä, taloudellinen tai poliittinen, vaikuttaa omistussuhteillaan siihen, mitä kansalaiset ja sitä kautta myös muu maailma saavat tietää? Minkälaisia asenteita heille välittyy joukkotiedotuksen kautta? US Media on omistussuhteiden palapeliä. Ja Tandem Production, amerikkalaisen television viime vuosien tehokkain yksityinen ohjelmatuotantoyhtiö, on suosikkisarjoillaan pystynyt haastamaan verkostot kilpailuun myös ohjelmien sanoman suhteen.
Do you feel yourself as the most powerful man in the media at the moment?
No, I don't. The most powerful people in the media are the people who own the hardware. By the hardware, I mean the networks. There are only three in America for 200 million people, and they determine, four men in each network, what will be seen by the bulk of America. So an individual producer can hardly be compared to the network, which has the capability of saying yes or no to any idea, and is only one of three groups that present entertainment to the entire country.
In the past 50 years, the American mass media have become dominated by large corporations, and this has had a significant impact on our society. It's an impact that people aren't too much aware of, but you have to be realistic. The media, their primary purpose today is to make money. Gone are the days where the people who run the media are journalists or are people with so interested in making a better society. They're businessmen, they're corporations, and they want to make money.
In the U.S., the three major type of media, we have TV and radio and newspapers. TV and radio, the electronic media, right from the beginning, were arms of the sales arms of the major corporations. They were conceived as advertising devices. And they've never reflected thoughtful analysis of political issues or economic issues.
This is something which I have long argued, that we have very heavy advertising for a wide range of products, automobiles, cigarettes, cosmetics, and alcohol. I don't deplore any of those. I don't use all of them myself, but I'm not going to stop anybody else from using them. But we don't have similar advertising for housing. We don't have similar advertising for health care. We don't have similar advertising for education. And the result is that one tends to get a distortion of production in favor of the heavily advertised products, which broadly speaking are the least important products, and away from very important things which aren't subject to this type of highly organized propaganda. I think this is the serious problem that results from modern advertising.
Well, for instance, in television, you have a situation where they have all of their income coming from advertising.
Kane Fried Chicken's terrific, and it's crisp.
I know.
Really crisp.
I know.
Crisp.
So that
crazy.
Means that they have to gear their programming to the advertising. They don't want to air something that's offensive or controversial. If they do, they'll lose audience. If they lose their audience, they lose advertisers. So what's happening is that, in general, the broadcast media try to air those things that will get the largest audience. That's usually that which is the least offensive, that which is not going to make anybody mad at them or the advertiser. And what it turns out to be is light entertainment, which is not really very good for our society. That's the problem. I think that's where the influence lies. They also, this great control that they have, permits them to decide what is news and what isn't news.
Kiihkeä katsojien verkkokalastus on amerikkalaista arkitodellisuutta taloudellisten tosiasioiden paineessa. Osakkeenomistajien ja televisiokatsojien edut vaan eivät ole välttämättä samansuuntaisia tässä ottelussa, missä ajatus voitosta ja tappiosta määrää sekä suunnan että tahdin.
How would you describe which way the stockholders behind those networks are using their power?
Well, there's an essential mentality now which is typical of the corporate society, which is indeed almost contemptuous of quality and believes only in the bottom line, the kind of profit. And as long as you make your 15% profit a year and you pay the dividends, you've had a good year. Your ratings are up. You pay dividends, 15% profit.
Everything is depends on ratings. If what you might view as poor television is rating extremely well, then it will succeed insofar as the network is concerned, and they will keep it on. This might be to the exclusion of a good idea, which would have succeeded had the network allowed it to remain for 10 weeks or 12 weeks or 15 weeks until the audience began to understand it, because perhaps it was a little more difficult to understand. So very often good ideas fall by the wayside because the network doesn't have the courage to suffer through low ratings until an audience reaches for it.
The argument, in fact, they would give to you or me if we were asking for better programs is that their responsibility is to this. Yes, oh yes, we'd like to have better programs. We're with you, you know, we'd like to do better things. But listen, we're a business and we have to make our stockholders happy, and we have to drive the stock up and pay our dividends. And the way we do that is to have high ratings. I mean, Mr. Paley of CBS, who is the architect of this system, I mean, really, he's the architect. He's a brilliant, talented man, but he's the architect of this dreadful system, always likes to say, oh, the worst thing I ever did at CBS was go public selling stock. Well, yes and no. I mean, he did exactly what he wanted to, and he's not unhappy with the programs. If he was unhappy with the programs, they would have better programs, but they are very mercantile.
The networks are publicly owned, and they're owned by stockholders, and studios are owned by stockholders, and they are run by people who are interested in the idea of profit and loss. And they're in business to make money, and the way you make money is by having products, films, that are watched by a lot of people on television or that get a lot of people through the turnstiles, you know, in the theaters.
There is no America. There is no democracy. There is only IBM and DuPont and Exxon. And you have meddled with the primal forces of nature. And you will atone. Am I getting through to you, Mr. Beale?
Why me?
It was your own television, dummy.
Vuonna 1961 liittovaltion viestintävaliokunnan FCC:n asiamies Fred Friendly nimitti televisio-ohjelmistoa äärettömäksi hylkymaaksi. Nicholas Johnson, FCC:n nuorin asiamies tuohon mennessä, yritti jatkaa uuden rintaman henkeä. Mutta 1970-luvulle tultaessa punottavakorvaiset teollisuusmiehet pääsivät eroon Don Quixote-häiritsijöistään, kun FCC keskittyi taas enemmän liiketoiminnan sääntöihin. Siten vuorokaudet ympäriinsä tulee tuutin täydeltä sitä, mikä keskimäärin halvimmin kustannuksin viehättää suurinta ja ostovoimaisinta yleisöryhmää. Viihdettä kaikissa muodoissaan, peleistä laulantaan, arvonnoista mukaviin juoruihin ja puheisiin, jatkosarjojen romantiikkaa, toimintaa ja pauketta. Maailman mahtavin sirkuskoneisto syöltää leipää ja huveja eniten haluaville ja vähiten tarvitseville. Ihailtavan ja pelottavan tehokkaasti. Ensimmäisistä havainnoista alkaen lasten mielikuvitukseen pyrkivät satusetien hanakat tarjoukset. Niitä luonnollisesti tarvitaankin virittämään ja kehittämään kuvaa elämän mahdollisuuksista. Mutta yksipuolinen pakkosyöttö aiheuttaa myös pahanlaatuista henkistä anemiaa, jos mikä. Amerikkalaisilla lapsilla ei ole keskimäärin yhtäkään kirjaa hallussaan ennen koulua, vaan sarjakuvakuplat ja ennen kaikkea televisioruutu ovat lähes ainoa ikkuna niin sanottuun ulkomaailmaan. Television merkitys todellisten elämänkokemusten korvikkeena on sitä suurempi, mitä vähemmän virikkeitä ympäristö antaa, oli sitten kysymys esikaupunki- tai slummikortteleista, yksinäisyydestä tai vastauksen jonottamisesta. Televisio on auki sitä enemmän, mitä vähemmän vanhemmilla on halua, aikaa, kykyä tai mahdollisuuksia opastaa jälkikasvuaan elämän lakien tuntemiseen. Koskemattomaan mieleen jäävät helposti väkivallan viidakon jäljet, vaan siitäkö hyödyntavoittelijat välittävät.
What's your favorite television program?
My favorite is Red Fox.
Why is that?
Because see, I like the Red Fox, you know, how he plays and asks silly questions.
What is your favorite television program?
One of them is Happy Days, because, you know, I have a lot of favorite TV shows.
Oh, like Happy Days, Bionic Man, different things like that.
I do too. Well, Happy Days and the Bionic Woman.
Oh yeah, I forgot that.
Why is that, that you like Bionic Woman?
Well, it's exciting and, sometimes they have parts and, it's good.
Do you ever get nightmares from the television shows?
Yes.
Why?
It's because some are scary, and I just think maybe it might happen.
Do you like to see those scary television shows and serials?
Yes.
Why do you like?
Because they're neat. And they're spooky and they're scary.
Peter Almond, what is the reason for the present level of the children's programming in the United States?
Well, when it's good, it's very, very good, and when it's bad, it's awful.
Dumb machine. Ask for more information.
Right.
More information.
The problem is that it's very low level most of the time, and that is explained by the basic structure of American television, as it applies not only to children, but across all age groups. For children, television is basically a money-making proposition in America.
Sure! Wow.
Televisioyhtiöiden selitys perustuu luonnollisesti niiden riippuvuuteen yleisön suosiosta, kuten Cox-viestintäyhtiön atlantalainen edustaja toteaa.
You must understand that most American television stations, other than public broadcasting or religious television stations, are solely supported by the advertising revenue. And so therefore, in order to make a profit, we must attract the largest amount of viewers in certain demographic groups. So therefore, it would not make much sense for us to program children's programming from, say, 4 until 5 or 5 until 6 o'clock, because our major news effort is a one-hour newscast from 6 to 7. So we try to work out of the afternoon soap operas into situation comedies or action-type things from 4 to 5 and 5 to 6, which we hope will keep us with the same audience. Into our 6 o'clock news.
Eräs ehdotus on vierittää koko vastuu eteenpäin.
I think that people have begun to understand that that the television that comes into their home does in fact have an on and off switch on it, and they literally can turn it off. And I think if a particular program that comes into their home is one that offends them, they will turn it off.
San Franciscolainen KRON-TV on eräs harvoista kaupallisista televisioasemista, jotka tuottavat paikallisesti televisio-ohjelmia lapsille. Syy tähän on ilmeinen.
The basic reason would be economic. Television is a business, and there are a lot of small stations that don't have the kind of money that it takes to do even a low-budget type of program.
It is based on the idea that the networks can attract a very large audience of children at a particular time during the week, which they can then present to advertisers and say, here, we will deliver to you a certain million level of viewers, usually in the many millions, and you can sell your products to them without any adult to be around to intervene in the television message and the child's reception of that message. So there is no history of setting a high standard for quality programming that would challenge the child's imagination, her or his intelligence. It is strictly a commercial proposition.
Where is Yuri? I do not know. He was not here when I arrived.
Then he has gone to destroy Gala. I shall return soon with Yuri.
This is Channel 4's Kids Watch. The Bay Area's most complete and up-to-date coverage of local and national kids news. Kids Watch.
Televisioyhtiöt siis vetoavat rahan vähyyteen ja huonoon tuottavuuteen, ja niinhän tekee usein painettukin media. Lehdistö, kirjojen kustantajat, kaikki, joiden kasvukäyrät ovat suoraan verrannollisia taloudelliseen hyötysuhteeseen. Koska kuvaruudun sanoma on lapsille, jos keille, enemmän kuin vain ajankulua, on riskienotto ohjelmiston laadun parantamiseksi perusteltu vaatimus. Ja sen ei aina tarvitse olla edes huono sijoitus, kuten Kids Watch, lasten uutislähetyksen tuottaja Christina Metcalf voi todistaa.
Well, we've gotten an enormous response from Kids Watch, both from our viewing audience and from the kids themselves who are doing it. The first night that we aired in the opposite time slot from Channel 5, a competitive station in their adult news, and we outrank them in the ratings, which of course is very important to American television, which means that the public was very receptive to that type of idea of having a children's newscast.
The rule is television which is the least expensive to produce, which will attract the most because of its gimmickry, its fast pacing, its clever techniques, its explosiveness, literally in the sense of violent activity, but it has no consistent standard for quality.
I think there's growing concern over the impact of television on children, and a substantial amount of research documenting that it in fact does affect young people's attitudes, beliefs, and behaviors about a variety of topics.
At the same time, television is recognized in federal reports, in scholarly research, as being the most pervasive, the most powerful influence now, equivalent to the influence of the parent, equivalent to all of the time a child spends in school, right up through college education. Television is the most important thing happening in the child's life, at least equal to these more traditional influences. And yet we allow it to remain a basically commercial structure with no intervention on the grounds that it is a basic influence of their moral outlook, their social outlook, and their internal, inner sense of themselves.
What does it say, Walt?
Behind every man, there's a doll. Look under life-size dolls.
Though violence has been the topic most looked at in this country in recent years, there is a growing amount of research on how it affects children's sense of what it means to be a boy or a girl, or a man and a woman in this society. It affects their sex role perception as well now.
The profound image that an American child receives from media, primarily through television, is that of a male-dominated society, a society where a large automobile is something to strive for, where material goods are the primary goals. Appearance is terribly important to success. All the models on television, with some interesting exceptions, are very attractive younger men and women who look rather perfect and create an image that's virtually impossible for the average person to achieve. And at the same time, the idea is that the way to achieve those standards, those images of perfection, are through rather ruthless competition. And in order to make it, to achieve this appearance, these goods, this image that television continually puts out to all of us and is so influential to children, you must ignore your fellow person or even step across him and step over him or her to get where you want to go. And this is very closely linked to the American idea of competition and of aggressive ambition.
Mitä on tuo amerikkalainen menestys ja kenelle se lankeaa? Auringonpaistetta, palmuja, avoauto, kaunista seuraa, paljon jäitä lasissa ja vähän huolta huomisesta. Menestyvien maailma, korkeaoktaaninen Eldorado, kangastelee useimmiten vain ihmisten mielikuvituksessa. Siinä lavastetussa todellisuudessa, mitä auringonlaskun kadun kaupparatsut yrittävät todistella oikeaksi ja tavoittelemisen arvoiseksi. Action for Children's Television. Toiminta lasten televisioon hyväksi alkoi vuonna 1969, kun joukko Newtonvillen, Bostonin erään esikaupungin kotiäitejä,
kokoontui rouva Peggy Charonin johdolla miettimään, mitä olisi tehtävissä kuvaruutosaasteen torjumiseksi. Ja ei aikaakaan, niin televisioyhtiöt joutuivat kavahtamaan Actin vastaiskuja niin oikeusistuimissa kuin julkisessa sanassa. Perusteista ei todellakaan ollut puutetta.
In America, children watch on average 25 hours a week, which is a lot of television. It's more than most countries have for a week of programming. So that's why the problem is particularly serious here. And we feel that that part of the problem has to be a parent's responsibility, but that the broadcaster has to put on programming that is the best programming he can design for children.
But there are good programs on. I think that 5 or 6 years ago, when Peggy Charon created Action for Children's Television, she put a tremendous pressure on American television for change. And it had a tremendous effect, because suddenly, if you did not program for children, if you didn't consider them as an important audience, you had a chance of having your license revoked. And of course, since it's a commercial enterprise, you wouldn't want that to happen.
One thing we noticed when we monitored programming at the beginning was that over one quarter of the hour was devoted to commercial messages. This means 16 minutes an hour or up to 32 messages an hour.
If you have fun eating Drake's cakes, wait till you see the fun we have making them. My chocolatey devil dogs are bound.
That's a lot of time to sell children sugared foods that most doctors feel they shouldn't eat in the first place, and toys that are so expensive that most people can't afford to buy them. We have managed to reduce that by 40%. So now there is something over 9 minutes per hour on weekend children's television, which is about the same as adults get in prime time during the whole week. It still is for the wrong products, but it is an improvement.
The networks have a great capacity for reading what's in the wind and moving to self-regulation if they think it's going to be demanded.
At the beginning, they sort of told us to go back and do the dishes, was an approach to, most of us were women, and that was the kind of the way we were treated by a lot of the industry. As we grew and as we came across as a professional organization that did its homework, the attention of the industry became much more serious.
But to tell you the truth, I think ACT in some ways went after the wrong enemy. They went after commercialism on children's shows and the selling of candy and toys. I don't like it, but I don't think it is particularly evil as compared, or damaging to children as compared to the televised violence. And I wish in retrospect that ACT had gone after television violence, and perhaps they will now. I think the whole country who cares about these things are is increasingly concerned about the violence.
Well, I think that television viewing should be limited because a real life experience is much more important to a child than watching someone else do it anyway. Plus, there's a lot of programs that children shouldn't be watching. Programs that are geared for an adult audience, which are bad for adult audiences too. All the violence that's on American television, I think, affects us all. I know it affects me. It makes me paranoid if I watch those programs, and I can imagine what effect it has on children.
The reason that there was so much violence in American television, and particularly in television for children, was that the whole need was to meet the need of the advertiser, and the broadcaster gets paid by how many are in the audience. You get more money for that commercial message if you have a bigger audience. So in trying to reach the largest number of children, in fact the broadcasters called it the 2 to 11 year old market when we spoke to them, in trying to reach the largest share of that market, the broadcasters ran the same kind of programming, the Violet Adventure kind of programming.
I think there is going to be a general decrease on violence because the critics, the researchers, and the consumer advocates like Action for Children's Television have really made the point that violence on television can cause a certain amount of aggressive behavior in our children, and that the inadequate portrayal of sex roles, or this distortion in the way men and women and boys and girls are shown in television, really can create problems.
They've upgraded Saturday morning a little bit, what we call the Saturday morning ghetto of children's programming on the three networks, but it still is pretty low level, pretty inexpensively produced, and I would say they do the very, very minimum of pro-social things for children that they can get away with.
Raskaasti hyväksi käytettyjen ryhmään kuuluvat Yhdysvalloissa myös ja ennen kaikkea naiset. Päiväunia naisille, unihiekkana haaveet, nukkumattina töllötin.
Everyone else is clipped green, which we're going to talk about in just a second. And there's somebody from New Brunswick, Canada. Where is that?
I'm having daydreams about night things in the middle of the afternoon. And every night you make my daydreams come true. All day long while you're working in town, time slows down to a crawl. When I'm not thinking about you, I'm checking the clock on the wall. Then it's goodbye factory, hello love, and there's a smile across my face. 'Cause I'm back in the arms of your sweet love, where my thoughts have been all day. I'm having daydreams about night things in the middle of the afternoon.
Kaikki ei ole kultaa, mikä kiiltää, ja tosielämän käsikirjoituksissa ei ole aina happy endiä. Silti noiden päivästä toiseen jatkuvien saippuaoppera-jatkokertomusten veto on ilmeinen. Ne peittävät alleen sen, että amerikkalainen nainen on alistettu ja alistunut paljon enemmän kuin haluaa myöntää. Pioneeriaikojen topakat äitihahmot ovat väistyneet, nuoruuden ja vapauden ikuiselle alttarille uhraavat ja jumppaavat teessä itse teinitytöt ja tehonaiset sotameikkeineen ovat astuneet kuvaan. Asenteet imeytyvät ja siirtyvät hiljaa äidiltä tyttärille, mutta tuleeko kehitys johtamaan toiseen äärimmäisyyteen, miehenpalvojista itseriittoisiin ja itsensä avoimesti tyydyttäviin naisrooleihin, siihen eivät kuvasarjat vielä vastaa. Joukot ovat vasta heräämässä.
Audiences are targeted for those people who buy television programs and want to advertise in television programs. The target audience primarily is women 18 to 49 years, because they're considered to be the group that has the most significant amount of buying power.
I don't think that they have questioned their desirability for the advertisers. And the proof is that they have permitted commercials which are cruel in their description of women. We look like imbeciles as we are portrayed generally.
Some sprays go on wet, some roll on sticky, but you rub our...
If a rag at the end of our hands could bring such joy, we'd all be cleaning surfaces with a product. There is a description of women in America on television that is an embarrassment to me every day of my life. And so I make the attempt to go the other way. Whenever I speak of a woman's choices, it is never with the image that is displayed on television. And I would hope to be an example against advertising.
Vastakkaisina esimerkkinä toimiminen on näennäinen ilmiö, mikäli samalla ei pysty haastamaan koko järjestelmää. Kokonaisuus on kovin toisenlainen ilmeeltään.
What kind of teacher television is? What kind of things it mostly tells?
Oh, I think it tells our young people about the way life is as it's seen on television. I think it tells young people what's appropriate to do if you're a woman, who you can touch, who you can talk to, what you can do. I think it tells young boys what's appropriate to be a man, that you have to drive a big car, you have to score, you have to always be independent, you can't cry. It gives very special messages about what it means to be a man or woman and how men and women should relate to each other. We see on television men relating to men and men relating to women, and less than 10% of all television relationships are between men and women, I'm sorry, are between women and women. So the young girl watching television thinks that women simply don't talk to each other very much, that they really better focus on how they learn to appeal to and talk to men. Gives very important messages about that to young people.
Sex roles remain a very serious distortion in the way television treats them. The idea of women is usually very inadequate people, or as supportive to a powerful man, remains the rule of American television, both for children and in the evening time for adult programs.
Women are not in positions of power and control in the production of television programs in this country in general. And secondly, there's some evidence that they don't even control the television viewing within their own home, except during certain hours. Generally, men control what programs are watched in the evening, and if the male head of the household is not making that decision, very often the child is. So that women don't exercise control over what's on the air.
Miten sitten näkee tilanteen nainen, joka harvinaista kyllä on määräävässä asemassa amerikkalaisessa televisiotuotannossa?
I'm confident that women are misrepresented in the media when they're represented at all, and they occur in the media very infrequently. The reason for that is not hard to find. Women are in the minority as the creators of media. This industry is the most joyous place to work in the entire world. It's fun, it's up. It's up means very exciting. It's very well paid. It's stimulating and creative, and there's elbow room, lots of expansion opportunities for your creative abilities. All of those things make it a wonderfully desirable place to be, and women are not the power structure in this country. And so it's much more difficult for them to achieve the roles in society that are desirable.
I think you have to understand the purposes of American commercial television, which is to sell an environment, an attitude in which your product will be bought. And so you sell a picture of American life that is conducive to selling toilet paper or dish cleaning detergents or whatever it is.
There is a change, and I think women are demanding to be seen differently, and they're tired of the pressure of being spotlessly clean and pleasant and cheerful and serving. I think both men are tired of those kinds of women, and I think women are tired of being that kind of woman.
Sometimes they get very disturbed by the very happy situation comedies where everything is wonderful. Mom is happy and dad is happy and 5.3 children are happy, and in 20 minutes a small family crisis gets raised and solved. I think very often we don't give a more accurate picture of the normal conflicts and tensions that occur in family life, and that men don't always know what to do, and that women can be assertive and solve problems. We don't give a very diversified picture of what life is like, either in our country or in any other country that I know of.
Today in American television, 70% of the roles are male, and only 30% are even cast as female. So we're simply not there.
Have you thought what has been the reason, you know, to this kind of direction? Is it only to blame of the male chauvinist pigs, or?
No, I think men are as big a victim of the general American mythology as women. I think sometimes men are greater victims. They die of heart attacks sooner than we do. We may, somebody, a very bright young female once told me that the problem with chauvinism is that a man has two burdens, his and hers. So I think that burden is hard for a man to carry, to live up to this business of being the strong one of the duet. He does the thinking, she does the feeling. That's generally how it's broken down in America. If you look at a soap opera, the women are always crying and the men are always coming in as if they had no jobs and solving problems. They're all lawyers and doctors, but they're all managed to be home for coffee and solving a problem. So I think it's a dual myth which is continued. However, it's interesting to watch, and it's hard to resist that clear-cut definition of man-woman, which is horrible.
Thank you.
tasa-arvotaistelu televisioruudussa on Yhdysvalloissa lähtenyt liikkeelle nimenomaan uutislähetysten yhteydessä. Amerikkalaisen käsityksen mukaan, kun on ollut jotenkin mainitsemisen arvoista, mikäli uutistoimittajana on esiintynyt nimenomaan naispuolinen henkilö. Tähtien tekemisen tarve, nostamisen ja laskemisen pakko ovat syöpyneet hyvin syvälle myös sähköisen uutisten välityksen sisimpään liikevaihdon parantamiseksi.
In this country, we are very youth-oriented. And I think that for a woman, particularly if she's going to work on camera, the chances are that she will be a younger woman than her male counterpart.
Thank you, gentlemen. This is Walter Cronkite at CBS News Election Headquarters.
Nobody is going to take Walter Cronkite off the air because he's over 55. But for a woman, when she reaches over 35, it's not all that easy.
I'm here this morning with Gene Shalit and Jane Holloway.
Good morning, all.
Good morning, and in this half hour, Catherine Mackin reports on California's interesting Senate race, which may or may not spark the interest of California voters.
And I will have just a few words on famous last words.
Eri televisioverkkojen uutis- ja ajankohtaislähetykset aamuisin olivat se paikka, missä naisellinen esitystyyli pääsi erityiseen arvoon. Sitten Barbara Waltersin onnistui sananmukaisesti hypätä iltaan, kun hän teki $5 million sopimuksen ja ryhtyi ABC:n iltauutisten toiseksi pääjuontajaksi vuonna 1976. NBC:n aamu-Barbarasta tuli ABC:n illan tähti ja kansikuvatyttö, ja puhetta riitti luonnollisesti niin katsojien kuin virkasisärten ja veljien puolella.
While she was the hostess on the Today Show, she had more time to do this syndicated program.
How do you feel about these big showbiz events like buying Barbara Walters with $5 million to ABC, etc.?
Well, I think that profession, what she is doing, is in some ways very much removed from what I do. She has prepared a product and she has sold it to the highest bidder. And that can, in this country, only get you admiration. It is nice that she is a female. It is nice that her product is good enough to sell for that price. I don't think it has a lot of effect on what I do. Because the realm of possibility does not exist other than in that situation.
If Barbara Walters and her appearance on the ABC Evening News raises the level of viewing one percentage point, the ABC television network will see $1.5 million in revenue annually come in, and as prices continue to escalate, they'll see more. And if it's two percentage points, then it's $3 million annually investment for a $1 million contract. And most businessmen, I think, would take that deal anytime.
I don't like nobody that's got an attitude.
The $5 million girl, we have the $6 million man. Not really. I think the network, being as progressive as the ABC television network is, felt that it was a time that a woman was utilized in a primary anchor role and not just a reporter on the set presenting the news. And I think that's the reason, a progressive attitude.
ABC-televisioverkko siis joka tapauksessa laski hyötyvänsä saamastaan julkisuudesta. Mutta jäikö uutis- ja tiedonvälitys samalla dollarikohun varjoon?
The presence of a female alone is not enough. But I know that when Barbara Walters co-anchored with Harry Reasoner, I thought, why wasn't that done before? Don't you think that men look kind of silly, all serious, and sitting on top of arms on top of a desk, explaining the world? Wasn't it nice finally to see a female who has a different configuration and different manner informing us of something? It will always be different now. Next, you'll see children there, too.
I think that it does make it easier for women to get the higher paid jobs. She will also be the first female in prime time. So, of course, what it means is the possibility that the other stations will want to hire females to compete with her now becomes realistic. So, in that way, it's good. In some ways, it's bad because now you have to ask, is news more show business than it is the art of reporting what's happening to people. And I think that that poses that question, but it, you know, it has two sides.
I think she's worth whatever she can get. And I think Harry better do some more negotiating because she looks very good. Everybody she interviews calls her by her first name. Anwar Sadat calls her Barbara, refers in their conversations to Henry. I haven't heard Anwar calling him Harry. So there seems to be a capacity for intimacy, which Barbara has brought.
Läheisyys ja luottamuksellisuus televisiokameroiden edessä on valitettavan usein vain hyvin harjoitettu ja kannattavaksi todettu silmänkääntötemppu. Amerikkalainen televisio on kiistämättä parhaimmillaan juuri uutislähetysten nopeuden suhteen. Kokonaan toinen kysymys on sitten se, välittyykö samalla todellista tietoa ja miten paljon vauhdikkaiden kuvien, sujuvien puheiden ja leveiden hymyjen taakse peittyy totuuksia yksilön ja yhteiskunnan syvimmistä ongelmista. Kunniakas TV-dokumenttiperinne on jäänyt moniin jalkoihin.
Good morning. It's today, Wednesday, October 27th, and in the news headlines today, the presidential candidates head east, campaigning in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and New York. Both candidates stumped yesterday in Illinois, a key state with 26 electoral votes.
Two, three. Then just plug them in and turn them on.
Time now, 8 minutes after the hour.
In Moscow, a fire at the old Hotel National across the street from the Kremlin drove hundreds of guests
This magnificent sectional sofa was designed to dress up any living room or den. But surprise, it's also a full-size sleeper.
$8.50.
No kidding. Hey, Mom, can you lend me $5?
What is this spell that's on me? Makes me think you own me.
It's almost 17 minutes after the hour, the Supreme Court.
With spectacular savings, 20% off the 7-piece no-stick aluminum cookware sets. 25% savings on these colorful, casual dinnerware sets. Choose from these stainless steel blackware sets.
Oli uutislähetys mihin vuorokauden aikaan hyvänsä, nopeus ratkaisee. Ja niinpä kilpailussa joudutaan turvautumaan toinen toistaan kyseenalaisempiin ratkaisuihin.
John, what do you think about so-called happy news, happy talk phenomenon in television?
I think that it's more of a fad than a fashion. And I think that true, honest journalism has always been fashionable, always will be, and that the viewer, to a large extent, gets cheated when the half hour or hour of news is filled with a lot of laughter and a lot of joking.
There's definitely a touch, at least, or a flash of showbiz in television news. I think we have to separate the two. We always have to maintain the difference. Where American news media is going now, I don't really know.
We have this problem where they look for people who are nice looking and who speak morning, with good diction, who can present a good appearance on television. And that's always going to be a problem because television is an entertainment medium. In TV news, they feel like they have to entertain their audience as well as inform them.
Do you think that people believe now more in a printed press than on television?
No, I don't think so. But I don't think they really believe a great deal of what they read or what they see.
The correspondents. I'm Sander Van Oker, NBC News.
Miten toinen kokenut uutismies Bill Leslie kokee vallalla olevan korostetun miellyttämisen tarpeen seuraukset?
I think primarily most of the reporters these days are a little too shy. They're afraid of the establishment. They're afraid of rocking the boat. Of going in and tackling an assignment, no matter how assured they are that the information that they have would be justified in bringing before the public. They're threatened with, in many cases, the establishment as far as reprisals back down the ladder through their own management.
Ajan, päivittäisten lähetysminuuttien tai lehtipalstojen vähyys johtaa helposti hutkivaan journalismiin tutkivan asemasta. Vain viihdyttäväksi tarkoitettu ohjelmatyyli ei salli suurempia vakavoitumisia tai yhteenottoja.
I think that on television it is very, very difficult to do any kind of in-depth undercover investigation because you're dealing with cameras and you have to go lugging around. It's very hard to be sneaky when you're lugging around a 100-pound camera. And doing any kind of that kind of undercover investigative work is hard. Partly for the equipment and partly because eventually the reporter gets recognized. I tried to do an underground assignment and I put on a wig and glasses, and at the end of my dance lesson I was looking into dance studio practices. The man said, you know, you remind me a lot of Sharon King. So I decided that wasn't going to be the most effective way to deal with it on television.
We do make efforts at investigations. We have recently put 3 members of our staff on the welfare rolls through illegal payments to welfare officials. And we filmed from a van and photographed the actual handing over of the money. We received welfare checks in our office. I mean, the thought that a television station could buy its way onto the welfare rolls is fairly shocking. So we'll do that kind of an investigation.
I had an incident recently where the police cars here, I was looking into one phase of first aid training for police officers. And as I went on, I found out that the reason that police officers don't administer any first aid is because they haven't got any first aid kits in their cars. And I checked further and found out that they did have them there at one time. All of the cars were properly equipped. Well, it turns out that the reason they're not there now is because the police officers themselves stole the police units.
The company sees it one way and they believe that is absolutely right. And the consumers may see it the other way and they may think they are absolutely right. And maybe as much as we can do is to try to show people both sides of the story and let them make up their minds about what they think is right or wrong or how they want to act or what they want to buy.
A lot of people won't want to be quoted. A lot of people clam up. Whenever you walk in with a camera, and naturally, they all tend to shy away from saying anything of any substance. You get a lot of comments off the record that you'd like to use, you know, that you can never use.
I have been in television for 15 years at both networks and local stations, and I have not, except in the rarest of instances, ever felt the cold hand of the censor. And I would really doubt in the area of an investigation into something like the intelligence community that anyone would really lean on us. In fact, if someone were to lean on me not to do something, that would indicate to me that there was something to be done. And I think that would work against the people who would try to suppress anything. I think the problem in an investigation into intelligence, if you were gonna do that kind of story, is that you don't have the men, the money, the time that's required to find out what's been going on for the last 20 years. Because the people who have been running the intelligence community in this country, underground, have it all covered. The track is fairly cold, and it will take a great deal of digging, you know, to find out what's there. We don't know what's there.
It depends on what level, the level at which you're looking into things. If you're talking about interviewing higher echelon executives about a problem concerning their various fields, you're not going to get much cooperation. Yeah, you need to get down into lower levels. That's where the people know, and that's where the people will talk.
You're never afraid to say the truth, because the truth is different to two different sides of the story. And so you just say the truth as both people see it, and you have to let the audience decide which they think is the truth to them.
Armoton kamppailu katsojaluvuista on houkutellut jopa yritykseen ostaa vallankaappauksen televisiointioikeudet. Suorana lähetyksenä on välitetty myös itsemurhia, mellakoita, kaappauksia ja sotaa.
I think primarily the media, the electronic news media, is concerned too much with the ratings. They're becoming too impressed with how great they are. And the numbers reflects too heavily in what they're concerned about as far as the information they're getting back to the people.
I was talking to a documentary producer for one of the large networks, and I asked him, why don't you ever do a documentary on minority problems in the mass media? Because today the minorities are becoming very active in trying to get a voice in the mass media. Almost every station in the country has had some legal lawsuit against it because of this problem. Yet you never hear anything about it in the media. And the answer that I got was that the people that run the network didn't think that the American public wanted to know about that. In other words, they chose to ignore it. They choose not to make news out of it, when in fact it is news. It's a tremendous movement going on in the nation that they're choosing to ignore.
The American documentary, in terms of television, which one associated in the early days with Edward R. Murrow, I think was overtaken by events. In those days, television was very new. And Ed Murrow was a very dramatic person who made the transition successfully from radio to television. But he was the foremost voice and image of the electronic age in news. And there were also some good documentaries that came out of NBC in the early 60s, the White Paper documentaries. But then there got to be so much news coming out, hourly news on radio, evening news, local news shows got extended, that it became a great clutter. And they didn't get ratings. And that's the real reason why I think that they're not put on much anymore.
Documentaries, television is learning its way. It's finding what it can do best, better than the print press. And the print press has got to learn what it can do better than television. So they complement each other, because we're in a television culture in this country, and for the print press to ignore that and to pretend that it still brings the people the news first is ridiculous. But I don't think the fact that television has to appeal to a wide audience diminishes its effectiveness.
And there's something else. Documentaries usually try to tell you that this was very important, that you should know about this. They got a little serious. And after a while, if you tell everyone that everything is very important and everything is very meaningful, then nothing becomes very important and nothing becomes very meaningful, and they lost their bite. And all documentaries that are good should have a bite, should say something, should have a hard edge. But they don't have them anymore.
The fashion now is to say there can be no such thing as objective reporting, and I think that's true. Nobody is truly objective, and any reporter has to make a judgment as to what he includes in his story and what he leaves out. Any editor has to make a judgment when he decides which story is emphasized and which one isn't. So objective reporting is a dead end. It doesn't exist. On the other hand, that doesn't say that there can't be both fair and unfair reporting, and the objective should be to be fair, not to be totally neutral about everything.
Do you think it's a burden for a reporter if he feels very much for some cause, or he feels very much for some individual, for example, a politician working for, etc.?
Oh, it's a burden. It's a burden. You have to be, you know, we all are human beings. We all have likes and dislikes. The only thing we owe to the people we cover is to be fair to them. But sure, you like certain politicians more than you like other politicians. Sure, you like things, events, more than other events. Sure, covering in the South, I was very sympathetic to the plight of the blacks. But I was also very sympathetic in those days to the plight of the whites in the South. And this is especially interesting in the light of our election, because they carried a burden in the South too, and I used to leave the South feeling torn by the struggles on both sides. I don't believe in this idea that you ought to hold back your emotions, your passions. Just be fair, but put passion into what you do, and it's going to be good television. Thank you.
tällainen mä oon. Kelpaan taikka en.